Hi everybody, it's Jeanette, and we are back for part three of our chapter two lecture. We last left off talking about survey research and how it really offers us an opportunity to collect a lot of data from a large amount of people in a relatively short and efficient way. But we always have self-report issues where people may not report accurately because they want to be viewed in a favorable light, or because maybe they don't have an objective evaluation of themselves. And so we're not really sure we can collect the same validity of information or the same depth of information that we may be able to obtain through other means. Another issue that might affect our ability to gain accurate information is the concept of a representative sample. So I want to talk to you a little bit about the difference between a sample and a population. A population is a whole group of people that you're interested in studying. So if I wanted to look at aggression in children, that's every child in the world. Maybe I want to narrow my population to the United States. Maybe I want to narrow it to California. It's impossible to study every single child in the entire world. It's pretty impossible to study every child in the United States. And it's still pretty impossible to study every single child in California. Even if I narrow it further and say, okay, I want to study every single child in Riverside County, that's still a pretty huge amount of people, and it's impractical, and I likely won't be able to collect data from that amount of people. So what we need to do in research is we take a sample, and I liken this to 31 flavors. So I don't need to eat that whole 5-gallon drum of Rocky Road ice cream sitting in the 31 flavors freezer to know what Rocky Road tastes like, to know the different flavor combinations, to know, you know, what it goes well with. I don't need to eat that whole 5-gallon drum. Instead, I can take just a sample, that little tiny sample spoon, and that sample gives me a really good idea of what the rest of the population tastes like. So the 5-gallon drum is the whole population of ice cream. That sample, that little spoon, is a pretty good indicator of what the rest of the drum tastes like. But only if my sample is representative. If on the spoon all I had was a marshmallow, I would not know what Rocky Road tastes like. If I only had an almond, I would not know. If I only had the chocolate ice cream, I would not know. For me to truly know what that Rocky Road ice cream tastes like in that whole 5-gallon drum, I need a little bit of each piece on my spoon. I need a representative sample. So populations are the overall groups of individuals that are of focus, that's our target. But practically speaking, we can only collect data from a subset of those individuals, which is our sample. And we want to study the sample to generalize to the entire population. I eat the small sample, whether it's a spoon or a cup or a cone, I eat that sample and I generalize that this is what all of Rocky Road ice cream tastes like, at least from 31 flavors. Again, that sample needs to be diverse and it needs to be representative. I need every ingredient on my sample spoon to know what my whole drum tastes like. And the same is true in research. If my sample only consists of males and it doesn't include females, when females are part of my larger target population, then that sample is not representative because there may be inherent differences between males and females. If my sample is only Caucasians, when I am representing a diverse population, particularly that includes minorities, then my sample is not representative. So it's really, really important that that sample is diverse and representative of the larger sample, or the larger population that you want to generalize to. Another research approach is archival research. And archival research, and mind you, that sample and population applies to all these different types of research designs, whether it's survey research, or whether it's experiments or correlations that we're going to talk about or archival, we want to make sure that our data that's coming from the sample is representative and diverse data. So with regard to archival research is rather than kind of designing your own materials and doing a random sample and going and collecting your own data, you're really doing a study using data that's already been collected. And so often we collect a large amount of data. When we're doing a study, we collect extra data that's not directly related to our research question. And particularly when you're talking about like government agencies, they have extensive data that they have. And there's probably a lot of knowledge and power in that data. But people have to construct research questions and then analyze the data in order to answer those questions. So what you do instead of collecting new data, you rely on past records of data. And you look on those existing data sets to answer your research questions. So if I want to go back and look at academic records and see, you know, what type of people are enrolling in college in the last 10 years, and, you know, maybe look at age demographics and how those have changed over the last 10 years or something of that nature, I can go back and look at existing data on that. So it's kind of retrospective. Also, you know, this is sometimes simpler because I'm not interacting directly with participants. I don't have to invest that kind of time, so it can be very efficient. But at the same time, I can, what if I wanted another piece of data or information, or what if I wanted to ask another question? I can't do that. I can only work with the data that's available to me. So it's kind of like trying to cook a dinner and you can only work with the ingredients in your pantry. You can't run to the store and get new ingredients. You have to make whatever's in your pantry work. And that's kind of the same limit of archival research. And you know, you have to keep in mind that there may not be consistency between records in terms of maybe one school collected this piece of information, but the other school didn't. So you're limited to what you have available. So you have to kind of make it work. Developmental research is adding an extra layer of complexity or an extra ingredient into the research mix. So not only do we want to understand maybe the relationship between media violence and aggression levels, but we also want to understand how that relationship or the influence of that relationship might change over time or change with age. So maybe violence on television has a different effect on children's aggression level than it does on teens, than it does on early adulthood, than it does on middle adulthood. And so I want to employ research methods that will allow me to look at the effect of time on my dependent variable, or the effect of aging on my dependent variable. So I want to look at how something changes over time. And I have two options to do that. I have longitudinal research. And if you look at the root word of longitudinal, it's long. It's a long approach. And so you take one group of individuals and you follow that same group of individuals over time. So maybe I want to measure their aggression in childhood, and then I want to measure their aggression again in teenage years, and then I want to measure their aggression again in early adulthood, and then again in middle adulthood, and so on and so forth. And that's a very time-consuming process. The participants have to continue to be involved. The researchers have to continue to be involved. You have to have appropriate measurement tools that are age appropriate, you know, because how you would word a question for a child to understand it might be different than a teen, might be different than an adult. And it takes a huge investment of time and money to kind of make these happen and to practically carry out these longitudinal studies. And they're very vulnerable to what we call attrition, or when we lose participants. Particularly for longer projects that cover, you know, years or even decades of time. And so what we see is, you know, maybe you start out with 10,000, you go, you know, lose some and you end up with 9,000, then you end up with 8,000, so on and so forth. And so that makes it really hard to compare, because the 5,000 that you end up with and may have a different makeup than what they would have otherwise had if they maintained the full 10,000 original sample. So that's a bit of a problem. So what we do to kind of combat those problems and to shorten it so we can collect research data more efficiently but still have a developmental research question is we want to do cross-sectional research. Cross-sectional is all at one time, but I'm now looking at different age groups. So all the same age groups over different time periods is longitudinal. cross-sectional is all at one time, but different age groups all at one time. So instead of 10,000 people, where I have 2,500 children, 2,500 teens, 2,500 early adulthood, and 10,000 people that I follow in childhood, teens, early adulthood, and middle adulthood, now I take 2,500 people in childhood, 2,500 people in teens, 2,500 people in early adulthood, and 2,500 people in late adulthood, and I compare them to one another. So here I'm comparing the same group of people to themselves over time. Here I'm comparing different groups of people in different age groups all at the same time. And so cross-sectional helps me. I don't have this long drawn out design or expense, but what I do have now is the potential for cohort effects, because there's something that might be inherently different about one generation than the other. Like nowadays we see much more progressive and accepting attitudes toward the LGBTQ community that we didn't see in previous generations. So that might inherently influence them in particular research questions than it would than other cohort groups. So a cohort is a group of people you travel through time together. Our birth cohort is our most common cohort. So either way, both pros and cons, but we have those designs for developmental research. So nice visual, longitudinal, I'm following the same three people in year 1, year 5, and year 10. I'm measuring those same people as they get older. And cross-sectional, I have 1 1-year-old, 1 5-year-old, and 1 10-year-old. I'm collecting all the data at the same time from different age groups. Okay, so I'm going to look at why research is important, but I actually think I'm going to stop here and then come back to the next section, because I want to be able to get this all into one video. I don't want to break this up. So I'm going to stop and then come back and put the correlational discussion all in one video. So I'll look forward to seeing you after a quick break.